What did you say? Ignore those.
I said ignore those. We'll do Lehigh and Fordham. Within 90 seconds. One minute. I don't know if I like this better or worse.
In here?
Like people walking by.
I do too.
Yeah, that, right? Yeah.
The busyness of it.
What's that? Like, just, it's cool with, like, ambiance. All right, live in 15 seconds, everybody.
One of the bridges from the end of one season and the start of another has been the first Wednesday of February. A busy day for college football across the country, including here in West Long Branch, New Jersey. National Signing Day for the Hawks next on ESPN. A day that is filled with excitement all around the country. Alongside Eddie Iacopinti, I'm Matt Harmon. We carve out a little piece of what's taking place in the Garden State here on the Jersey Shore. And Eddie, an exciting time. You know, you and I have done this for the last couple of years, and the excitement that kind of goes along with the day, it never seems to change from year to year.
Yeah, Matt, I think what changes with National Signing Day might be how national letters of intent are submitted. It might be the different ways that athletes unveil their decisions. But one thing that doesn't change, as you said, is the excitement around the day. It's great not only for the student athletes, but for programs across the country, for alumni bases, for fan bases, to know what the future of their programs hold. And obviously, it's an exciting day for a lot of young men who make big decisions today.
And this is a Monmouth program that next season will enter its 25th year of being a college football program. There's so much excitement going on. You hear Chris Hogan talked about with the New England Patriots. You saw that picture coming in to our broadcast here today of the new stadium. It's kind of a new era for this team and this program.
Well, this program, one of the themes we always seem to talk about on broadcast and also on National Signing Day, is the continued upward trajectory of Monmouth football on the national scene. You see that now with all of the success that the players that have left Monmouth and gone on to the NFL are having. And then you also see it, like you said, with that shot of Monmouth Stadium when we came onto our broadcast today. That represents a huge moment for this program and their continued steps forward in now another year in the Big South, another year of full scholarship football, and just the type of student-athlete that they're able to go and now bring into this program.
We'll cover what's taking place over the course of the next 75 minutes or so. And we've got a busy day planned for you. We'll spend some time with head coach Kevin Callahan. And if you think about the way that things have changed over the course of 25 years, one thing that's been a constant, he is still the school's only football coach as the head man.
Yeah, and one thing that you don't see in college football and college athletics is that steady presence, right? Is that consistency. And that's what this Monmouth football program has with head coach Kevin Callahan. Now, as a head coach, we've seen the program evolve and we've seen what they do kind of change and to always stay kind of on the cutting edge of what's going on in college football. But one thing that has remained constant, as you said, is that man, Kevin Callahan, leading this program from its inception back in 1993 through now full scholarship football in the Big South. And he has overseen, Matt, a program that, again, as we mentioned, has put players in the NFL, constant all-conference guys, a lot of record holders as well. And it's truly been a testament to not only his will and to his creativity for this program, but to the universities as well, that they are where they are.
We'll talk about 18 players players that will join the Monmouth program officially today. Two of those are mid-year signees. We'll talk to them during the course with Susie Milano, who will join us. We'll also spend some time with recruiting coordinator and offensive line coach Brian Gabriel. He's been a very busy guy the last, I'd say, several weeks, but it's really a full-year process these days.
Full-year process, and I want to ask Coach Gabriel what his phone charger looks like right about now, because I can imagine he probably needs another maybe two or three, because, Matt, he has been incredibly busy, as you said, as has all the members of this football staff, from head coach Kevin Callahan on down. But the job of the recruiting coordinator as that centerpiece to kind of bring classes together is incredibly valuable to every football program. And then more intimately, Coach Gabriel works with the offensive line. So there were some players brought in on that position group, a lot of position groups represented, Matt, in this 18-member class, as you said. And we're excited to not only speak with Coach Callahan, Coach Gabriel, get the thoughts of our mid-year players as well. It's going to be a good day.
Yeah, we've got some fun stuff planned as well. We were able to talk with Hakeem Vallis during the course of the week. He was on campus spending some time here in the program. You think about a name like that. We talk about Chris Hogan. We talk about Hakeem Vallis. That NFL pipeline for the Hawks has really opened up over the course of the last couple of years. Started several years ago with Miles Austin.
Started with Miles Austin, then include Neil Sterling as well, who's the wide receiver turned tight end with the Jacksonville Jaguars. And you're starting to see more Monmouth players make names for themselves in the NFL. And that just helps the next wave of Hawks come through. Once these NFL scouts and coaches see what exactly is going on in West Long Branch, they're that much more excited to get here and see what's going on. Future of this program incredibly bright, led by those players in the NFL, as you said.
18 new players. We will talk about each and every one when we return from this quick timeout. The Hawks unveiling their class of 2017. We're back after this quick timeout with more of our National Signing Day special from West Long Branch, New Jersey on ESPN. The excitement just getting up and going here. National Signing Day in West Long Branch. Talking about Monmouth University and the incoming batch of Hawks. Eddie Iacopinti, Matt Harmon. Eddie, you know, before we get into the 18-player class and really look at it, let's talk about what it's like to be back here on ESPN3 and the ESPN family and networks. We've been able to do this now the last couple of years. It provides such a great opportunity to talk about Monmouth football and all of these players coming in to be the brand new class of Hawks.
And Matt, it's a tremendous opportunity that we get to talk about, as you said, these incoming Hawks that come in. That's what this is all about. It's about the student athletes joining this football program, joining this university. We're incredibly lucky that we get to bring that to the college football and the sports world through ESPN3. And as you said, all of the ESPN family of networks and the platform that we get, pretty cool. The home games as well here at Monmouth University, we get to broadcast on ESPN3. So the ability that we thankfully get as alums to showcase these student athletes and coaches is pretty special.
18 players part of the class. We talk about the two mid-year signees as well. We will do this alphabetically. That's the order that we'll take it, and we'll start with a local product just by chance. The first one right around the corner, Joey Aldarelli, outstanding wide receiver, 6'1", 190 pounds, starred at Ocean Township High School. He should be a guy that when he gets on the field, he's kind of a big play impact type wide receiver.
And a bigger wide receiver than I think people are going to really notice when you see the film of Joey Aldarelli. 6'1", 190 pounds. Matt, as a senior, 50 catches for the nearby Ocean Township Spartans, 621 yards, 6 touchdowns. Sure-handed guy, not afraid to go over the middle, but did flash the big play ability that I think these coaches saw, and that's one of the things that they liked about Joey Aldarelli. Not to mention, played his high school ball, what'd you say, maybe 6-7 minutes away right down the street in Ocean Township.
If we got one of the Monmouth quarterbacks on a good day with the win, he might be able to throw the ball and hit Ocean Township High School. And that's been something, you know, we'll talk with Coach Callahan about it when he hops on. The recruiting process has always started here locally because the Shore Conference has always had very good football between Monmouth and Ocean County.
And it's something we talk to Coach Callahan about a lot on broadcast on this special every year. And it's a thing that has remained constant in this program. You mentioned the consistency with the head coach, the consistency with that approach as well. And if you can recruit well around your university, it helps other things too. Helps get the fans in the stands, helps get people to see these student athletes every day. But you said the football in New Jersey, especially around the Shore, is good. It's getting better kind of every year. And it's always been a pillar of this Monmouth program to recruit well in this local Monmouth, Ocean County, and then kind of outside area. But Joey Aldarelli representing the most recent in that line, as you mentioned.
Talking about going outside of the air, and next player that we'll talk about here for Monmouth, you always wind up getting a couple on both sides of the ball, offensive and defensive linemen. This one on the defensive side, Kurt Almer, who's from Pennsylvania, Acme, Pennsylvania, 6'3", 260 pounds.
Yeah, played both sides of the line when he was in high school, projects as a defensive lineman here at Monmouth University, 6'3", 260 pounds. How about the year he enjoyed as a senior? 18 tackles for loss, 47 solo stops, and a player that was an all-conference pick. Matt, he has a lot of good football pedigree in his background, and you can never have enough really good offensive and defensive linemen, especially with what we see every week in the Big South with how strong those teams are as well. So this is a nice get. You can never have enough, as we said, and we'll talk to Coach Gabriel about it as well. Offensive and defensive line help. Kurt Almer, the latest, that will now go to a very deep defensive line. His Mama team likes to play a lot of guys up on that defensive front.
A position of maybe need when you look at this recruiting class would be the running back spot. There are a couple that will come in this class. We'll start talking about the spot itself in just a minute, but Mike Bowers is a guy who's a defensive back, and you think about what takes place on that side of the ball. You just said speed-wise, running back is one that jumps out at me, but defensive back is also one that jumps out at me. So important to have guys that can run, that can tackle, that can fill. And you think about what Monmouth did defensively last year. They would play 4, 5, 6 guys all the time. It became pretty common to see 6 defensive backs. So Mike Bowers, who's the next guy we'll talk about, he should be an immediate help.
Not to, Matt, talk about the versatility, but also the size of Mike Bowers. With teams playing more and more defensive backs as part of their base defense or more on regular downs on first and second, the premium is on defensive backs that can tackle, as you said, that have great size. Last year on this day, we talked about Wendell Allen. He came in, played a lot as a freshman for this Monmouth team, and Bowers fits that kind of physical mold. 6'1", 190 pounds. He played both defensive back and wide receiver at a place that Monmouth is very, very familiar with in Cherokee High School down in South Jersey. And you said it, the size that now accompanies that, you need your DBs to stay on the field more, to be able to lend into run support, but also to cover on the back end. Mike Bowers physically fits that mold.
So of the first three, I will say, knowing New Jersey high school football like we do, you've got Ocean Township represented in Aldarelli. Fantastic program here at the Shore. You get Cherokee. What I like about the first couple of guys that we've mentioned, at least the ones from New Jersey, you're getting players from high schools that always have success.
Well, I was just going to say that when you recruit winners, it helps continue to fill a program with that winning tradition and with guys that know how to be successful. That just doesn't mean on the field on Saturdays, I guess primarily Saturdays because games are all over the place now, but it's every day in practice. It's in the weight room. It's in the preparation. If you recruit winners, it helps a program continue winning tradition. As you said, that's a huge point.
We started to touch on maybe a position in need. Defensive back was one. Running back is certainly another. You think about what Monmouth is losing at that spot. LaVon Cheney, who had such a fantastic career, Ed Royds, Zach Welsh. So that spot might be open for a player that is a freshman coming in. One of those that we'll talk about right now, Justin Brown, 5'10", 210-pound freshman coming in from Connecticut.
Good size, great explosive speed. Really pops off the film and is a big play ability to get into the open field. Had a great career. You mentioned it, all-purpose. That's something Monmouth's missing, the all-purpose skills that LaVon Cheney graduated with. He was the all-time leader among running backs with 90 91 receptions, led this team in rushing three straight years. You take a look at a player like Justin Brown, Matt, and he's got that kind of ability, did a lot of different things in high school. And now what I'm going to look forward to is, can he come in and make that kind of immediate impact? We know he had the great numbers. We know he has that kind of multi-talented, multifaceted skill set. That's what Monmouth is graduating with. Not only LaVon Cheney, but as you said, Ed Royds and Zach Welch as well. So positions of need, that's kind of the other side of National Signing Day. Want to bring in all these players, great day, but they're having to replace guys that are moving on and graduating.
And listen, we have no idea what will happen with guys when they actually get here on campus, how quickly you can contribute. But if you're a running back and you were looking for a spot among the schools, you were thinking, I would imagine that if you're a high school senior, you do go through and say, he's out, he's out, he's out. I might be able to come in and play right away.
You have to imagine that depth charts are definitely in the minds of players as they make decisions. And you said, if you're looking at this Monmouth team a year ago, which we'll talk about last year kind of later on in our broadcast, you see a lot of guys with that senior designation next to their name in the running back spot. A lot of production has graduated from this team. And we'll talk to Coach Cal and Coach Gabriel about that as well. And you can assume Justin Brown, a guy that they saw, maybe a guy who could come in and contribute immediately, knowing that you're losing so many guys at that spot.
We're four players into our 18-player discussion here. We've got head coach Kevin Callahan coming on later, offensive line and recruiting coordinator Brian Gabriel, talk with Hakeem Vallis as well. Susie Milano will join us with a couple of the players just a bit as well. Let's get back into the class. Player number five, Anthony Budd, defensive back, 5'11", 180 pounds. He's a guy from a spot, at least a state, that Monmouth has always done very well, Riverdale, Maryland.
Yeah, well, a state that Monmouth does well in, Matt, and just a phenomenal high school program down at Good Counsel. Monmouth has been able to go down there, get impact players, and that high school is putting out impact players every single season. Had a really great year last year, 61 stops, 5 interceptions, and again, at the size that he is, 5'11", a little bigger, he has also the ability to put on some more weight. When you see him on film, you know that he's a fast player, he's an explosive guy, but he's going to be able to come in and get stronger and will join a position of strength for this Monmouth team in that defensive backfield.
You know, the one number that if you look at that graphic that pops off, 5 interceptions, you've got to be able, in the league that Monmouth plays in the Big South, have guys that can go attack the football and create turnovers for that Monmouth defense. They started last year being able to do that, and then once they got in the league, they struggled with it a little bit. If you can find those playmaking-type guys, you'll be in good shape.
Well, if your defense is on the field, and Matt, Monmouth at times last year showed the big playability as a defense, causing turnovers, getting sacks, getting tackles for loss, that's huge. The way that football's played nowadays, you want to score a lot, and obviously you want to force turnovers. So a player that has that ball-hawking kind of skill that's going to play football and play man, that's incredibly important. Then when you get the football in your hands, make something happen.
Let's stay in the state of Maryland and on the defensive side of the ball. The first of a couple linebackers that we'll talk about, DeJuan Cooper, 6'2", 195 pounds.
And joins a great tradition of Monmouth linebackers that we've seen here. Go back to the days of Joe Santapaul, Mike Castellano. We've seen some really great ones during Coach Callahan's time at Monmouth. An outside linebacker is DeJuan Cooper, 6'2", Matt, right around 200 pounds. Again, another guy that has the ability to add some weight to him. Had a really impact season last year. We talked turnovers with Anthony Budd. Well, how about DeJuan Cooper and getting to the quarterback? 8.5 sacks this past season, over 70 tackles. Also not afraid to drop back in pass coverage. We talked about DBs being able to tackle more nowadays. Well, linebackers have to be able to cover more. That's kind of the way football has gone. And DeJuan Cooper has that kind of dual threat from a linebacker spot. He can support run. He can also get in pass coverage.
And comes from a successful program, 25-12 in his 3 years with the varsity program. So another winner that Monmouth is bringing in to the program. Let's go back on the offensive side and continue things. Terrence Green, 6'170-pound wide receiver from Philadelphia. A guy I know that Monmouth is extremely happy about getting. You pull those city guys every once in a while, they usually bring a little different attitude and element into the program.
And it's one of the unique things that Monmouth has being a member of the Big South. They're the most northern member of that conference. So they have the ability to be really strong, obviously always in New Jersey, but in Pennsylvania, down in the Philadelphia area as well. We mentioned winners. Terrence Green comes from a winning program. As a member of the team, he was part of 32-6 was the record. How about 14-0 as a senior? Couple of state titles. Matt had a really productive career as a senior, 48 grabs, 741 yards, but here's the key stat, 12 touchdowns. We talk about defensive backs that can make plays, can turn the ball over. You want receivers and running backs and skilled players that can find the end zone.
And finished his career with 76 catches, and you think about what Monmouth has coming back at that spot. Reggie White Jr., one of the most talented guys within the league. If you can add some more weapons around him, that Monmouth offense could be pretty potent.
Well, Reggie White Jr., as you said, he's the best receiver in the Big South, and I think he showed it last season, his continued evolution and development. But graduating a player like Darren Ambush, who was incredibly valuable to this team, not only as a receiver but as a return guy, I think that's where you take a look at some of these receivers that look and say, well, who's leaving a program? And there are some guys in the program the coaches are very excited about as well, but then you add a player the caliber and the talent of Terrence Green to the mix, and it just adds – you can never have enough weapons, and it just adds more to this offensive arsenal.
You can never have, I feel like, a spot – in terms of depth that could be challenged than quarterback. And I think this is an interesting year for Monmouth at the quarterback spot. And I feel like the couple years that we've been able to do this and talk about all the recruits, we haven't always spent a ton of time because Monmouth has been fairly set at the quarterback spot. Back to the days of Kyle Frazier, that led into Brandon Hill, maybe a little bit of a quarterback issue last year for Monmouth. So they're bringing in not one but two guys this year. Let's talk a bit about Brandon Harris. Comes from the Bronx, 6'2", 195 pounds.
And a player that put up numbers, Matt, not just throwing the football, but running the football as well. Over 3,200 passing yards in his career, 2,500 yards on the ground. He was pretty split in touchdowns. How about running for 44, throwing for 42? But when you watch film, big, strong kid, can deliver the football on time, strong arm, and a player that comes in with, again, that ability to have multi-skills. It's not one thing that Brandon Harris does on film, but he can make plays in a variety of ways. And when you can add a couple of quarterbacks, Matt, to a stable, you like to create competition. That's good. You want people to push each other every day in practice.
Had good success as a quarterback, so bringing that leadership element in to the Monmouth program as well. Kenji Bahar, you would assume, would take a bunch of the snaps during the course of this season, but I think after that, there would be some questions about who could be the two, the three, in terms of the overall depth. So it'll be interesting to see what some of these freshmen do coming in.
Well, and we've seen depth is incredibly important. When you talk recruiting, you can never have enough competition. You can never have enough good players, really, at one position. Because if someone goes down, if someone's got to step up, anything like that, you want to be able to not miss a beat, that next man up mentality. And I'm excited to see Brandon Harris come into Monmouth University and compete.
Back on the defensive side for our next player to talk about, Terrence Maynard from Easton, Pennsylvania, went to Wilson High School, 6'4", 220 pounds. So you think they're just looking at him. He should be more of a guy that comes off the edge or somebody that would be putting some weight on in the next couple years.
Well, and I think that's going to be a theme among everyone. One of the biggest things you want to get when you get these young players in is see exactly how they're going to develop physically. You know, can they support more weight? How much work they have to do in the weight room? I'll tell you what you can't teach. 6'4" coming off the edge. 220, you know he's going to be able to add some weight as well. You can never have enough players that can get after the quarterback. 15 sacks in his career, over 140 tackles, also contributed on special teams, and at 6'4", big body, long arm player that can get up and block some kicks, an all-conference guy who was twice a team MVP, and Terrence Maynard adds again, you can never have enough guys to get after the quarterback, especially as you talked about. In the Big South, you want to generate turnovers? Well, that's not always the defensive back's job. That starts up front with putting pressure on the quarterback.
Another one of those guys that might be able to do it in this recruiting class is our next player, Eric Massey, who comes from one of the most dominant football programs here in the state of New Jersey, Bergen Catholic. He could be another one of those hybrid guys, could play on the edge a little bit, could play some linebacker for Monmouth. But anytime you associate Bergen Catholic with the next level, it usually breeds success because they've always been one of the best programs in the Garden State.
Yeah, we talk about the Monmouth players that have gone on into the NFL. Well, if you go down into the Bergen Catholic ranks, look at all the players they've put into the NFL as well. It's a powerhouse up in North Jersey, and Eric Massey was a key reason for that this past year. 63 total tackles, 21 solo stops, had 10 sacks also, so he could play all along that defensive line. Matt, he was an all-league guy, he's an all-metro guy, and a player that will come in, add some great depth on that defensive line. Also, I love the old-school headshot too. That's what I want my defensive linemen looking like when they come in to campus. Looks like a player that can, as you said, also add some more weight, continue to get bigger, continue to get stronger.
You know, you think about defensively the schedule that Monmouth has played over the last couple years in league. I think we've touched on it. You need playmakers in the back. You need playmakers in the front. You need guys that can get off the edge, get to the quarterback, but players that can make stops and make plays in the defensive backfield. Let's talk a bit about Hassan Muhammad Chambers, 6 foot, another city guy, comes from Brooklyn, went to Christ the King High School. We'll talk about that program during the course of the afternoon as well.
Yeah, we will. well, Matt, in another solid program. It's one of those powerhouses out of New York City. And Hassan Muhammad Chambers comes in. He was a really versatile guy in high school. He played both defensive back and running back, projects as a defensive back at the next level. And we talked about size earlier with some of the DBs. Again, good size here. 6 foot. Anytime you're going against these receivers, 6'3", 6'4", 6'5", you want players that are physical on the back end that aren't afraid to kind of mix it up a bit and then step up in to run support as well and make stops. Another player, too, with the ability to continue to get stronger in his time. And I like this. When he gets the ball in his hands, if he's able to force turnovers, he's going to do something with it. He had 8 touchdowns over 500 all-purpose yards as well.
One of 2 mid-year signees for Monmouth is Jerron Pendarvis. He's a big run-stopping type player, plays that defensive tackle spot, 6'1", 295 pounds, comes to us from Monroe Community College, should be a guy that hops into the lineup and provides an immediate impact.
Yeah, I'm excited to not only see him on the field, excited to bring him onto the show as well. Had a really great run through high school and his time in junior college. You mentioned it, Matt. He was 29 stops, 8 tackles for loss last year, but this is what I like. 4 sacks and his ability to help create turnovers. Had a fumble recovery, had a pick as well, and a player that's more mature that's coming in. We keep talking about players that can get stronger, that can add weight. Well, this is a guy that comes in. He's ready to roll right away. It's going to be an interesting spring to see how quickly up to speed everyone gets that already is in the program, but I'm excited to speak with him later and also to welcome him into the program.
One tight end that is in this 18-player class, Herman Pimentel, coming 6'4", 210 pounds from New Brunswick, New Jersey.
Yeah, and one of the themes with Herman that you really like, he's a long athletic player. He's going to help stretch the field, especially down the seams vertically. 6'4", about 215 pounds, again with the ability to continue to get stronger, and he's a raw player with a ton of ability, and I'm excited to see what he'll have in store for this program moving forward. Matt came from another very successful program in New Jersey from just about 40 minutes away, and he'll add more or continue to add depth to a really talented position group, and that we've seen this group has the ability to send guys onto the next level.
The second of the 2 mid-year signees is another one of the quarterbacks Monmouth will bring in with this class, Max Smythe. Big body, 6'5", tall guy, should be able to see over the line pretty well. Had a fantastic high school career down at Palmyra.
Yeah, and the ball really flies out of his hand when you watch the tape. A lot of zip and a very live arm player, very successful as well. How about his senior year? Over 3,000 yards and 33 touchdowns. Also, Matt can do it with his legs as well, and you like that again. The flexibility, that a dual threat. But really, it's more than that. His ability to make plays. It's not just that he could be mobile, that he can get downfield as well. Max Smythe, a player that, again, he's a little old. He's more mature. He's a big, strong kid. And another guy that I'm excited to see what he can do this spring as far as getting ready for summer and then into the fall.
One of the local products that Monmouth will bring in along with Aldarelli is Justin Zuba. You think when you look at the size of this player, 6'7", 260 pounds. 6'7" is what jumps out at me. That should be able to you'd be able to keep people away from whoever your quarterback is, open up some lanes for the running backs.
Yeah, you hear 6'7" is an offensive lineman, and if I'm any of the quarterbacks we talked about, if I'm Kenji Bahar or anyone in the program, I like hearing that from Justin Zuba from just down the street down in Brick, and he's a player that comes from a very successful program. This team last year went 9-3, did very well into the state tournament, all-state guy, and a player, Matt, that comes in. And Monmouth's done well down there. One of their better players, one of the better players in all of FCS football, Mike Basile's a Brick Memorial guy. He's in the defensive backfield for this team, so Justin Zuba will be a fellow Mustang here at Monmouth University.
3 players left to talk about before we take a break. Let's go back on the defensive side of the ball. Justin Terry, a defensive back, also city guy. We mentioned Christ the King. This is the second Monmouth recruit. Has good size, 5'11", 175 pounds.
And Monmouth has done well. Again, we talked about in New York City. We haven't mentioned the name yet, but a couple of years ago, they had a really great safety with the name Jose Gums out of New York City. And Justin Terry will now come to the mix. And if he's as productive as Jose, the coaches hit a home run. A player that played both defensive back and wide out at Christ the King. Matt, 93 career stops. A ton of interceptions, also not afraid to get up, be physical in pass defense, had 16 pass deflections as well in his career, and another guy that played both ways. So a player that you look to when and if he's able to get those turnovers forced to do something with it. Good size and really good football IQ from Justin Terry. Excited to see him join that defensive backfield.
Yeah, certainly just a guy who's a playmaker by nature, a 3-star athlete that Monmouth will bring here, compete for a spot. Mark Wolf, offensive lineman, 6'4", 270 pounds from Williamstown High School. Again, Is there a spot you can never have too many bodies? Defensive, offensive line, you need to bring guys in every single year.
And a team in high school that went 9-3 his senior year, and he helped lead them to a state sectional appearance. He's a captain. You have an offensive lineman, you have a captain, you know what you're going to get from Mark Wolf. Leadership guy, first team all-league, 6'4", 270 pounds. We talked about positions of strength and positions of depth, and you can never have enough talented offensive lineman, willing to go out, willing to work hard as well, and he joins a group, and we'll talk to Coach Gabriel later. That's his specific position coach job, is the offensive line. Interested to learn more about Mark Wolf, but on film, a dominant run blocking guy and someone that's not afraid to mix it up.
We talked about the running back spot and maybe being a position in need and a position for an opportunity for a player to come in right away. The last of the 18-player class, Eric Sikori, who ran for just about 1,200 yards last year, a guy who loves to spend time in a spot running backs want to be, that's in the end zone.
Yeah, exactly. Gets to the end zone a ton, and he's only last by alphabetical because when you watch Eric Sikori on film, he's a big play guy. You can see from an area down in Maryland that Monmouth has done incredibly well, down in the Silver Spring area, and big play potential is what you see from Eric Sikori. Not only in the run game, also caught 19 passes for 362 yards and 3 touchdowns. He's a player that wants the football in his hands, and you watch him, doesn't need a lot of daylight, doesn't need a lot of room before he can make a big play, get their shoulders square, and get downfield.
So important for running backs in this Monmouth offense to be able to run and catch the ball out of the backfield. That's the 18-player class. We'll break it down by state. We'll break it down by position. When we return from this brief timeout, we'll be joined by Brian Gabriel, recruiting coordinator, offensive line coach. Eddie and I having fun here today. National Signing Day all across the country. We'll talk a bit more about the future Hawks coming up right after this.
Got it. Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can.
Yep.
So where are we starting?
Where you want to start?
Just the overall process, and then we'll get into the – we got tight ends, offensive line, wideouts to talk about.
Cool.
Right. He's doing the bottom three, right?
Receiver, O-line, tight end.
Mm-hmm. And then just like the whole day.
Cool.
Full day coverage on ESPN, ESPN3 of National Signing Day here in West Long Branch, talking about Monmouth University and the future Hawks. Alongside Eddie Iacopinti, I'm Matt Harmon. Brian Gabriel, offensive line coach and recruiting coordinator, good enough to give us some time. And coach, this 18-player class, we talk about it, 16 incoming freshmen, 2 already here on campus as mid-year transfers. You know, we took a joke before and said, you have been probably the busiest guy the last couple weeks, but, you know, it's a full year, almost full-time process to make sure that you get guys and probably more importantly can identify them early in the process.
Yeah, 100%. This is really began last January, this process, starting to identify juniors. We really started to look at these guys as juniors and evaluate their tape, start watching them. And then now to get to this point, which is the culmination of that whole process, some ups, some downs, but we're here today with a phenomenal class.
So you think there's 18 coming in. when these started, I mean, if you had to pick a guy, let's just say, when do you first become aware of these potential players? Is it freshman into sophomore, sophomore into junior year?
Yeah, I would say the most part sophomores. You know, we're right now we're looking at guys, and you know, you go to high schools, and coach starts giving you the names of the sophomores that you should have your eyes on. Start trying to get them to camp as sophomores. So a lot of these local shore guys we've known about since at least their sophomore year and following them.
Brian Gabriel, recruiting coordinator, offensive line coach. We'll break down a couple of the positions with Coach Gabe and then save the rest for Coach Callahan. We'll look at wide receivers, offensive line, and tight end. But how about just an overall feel? 18 new guys coming in. You know, every coach today is saying they're happy with the players that are coming in. But what makes this class maybe a little different and a little unique for Monmouth?
Well, I certainly think we went out and addressed positions of need. You know, we went out and got some D-backs, we got the running backs, we got the quarterbacks that were certainly in a need position for us. But we also, I think, have really started to understand the Big South, starting to understand the level of football we're playing now. And understanding that kind of allows us to have a better idea when we're looking at tape of guys who really fits us and who's going to help us take that next step in the Big South. So the quality of player and the ability they have certainly is a continued refined process as coaches so we can understand what we need to be successful at this level.
Yeah, Coach, when you kind of take a look with your other coaches and you do that, and now we've seen the Big South for a couple of years, and we know how good of a league it is, one of the best in all of FCS football, you still see you're able to find good players from a lot of the footprints that this program had here in New Jersey, down the street, in Maryland as well. How much of it is geographical and how much of it is you're just trying to identify the guys that can help this Hawks team get better?
Well, it's a combination of both. We certainly have always worked inside out here. I believe this is my sixth or seventh year as recruiting coordinator, and it was put on me early from Coach Callahan that that's the way we're going to operate. We're going to start on the shore. We're going to make sure we understand every player on the shore. As a matter of fact, we had a junior night the other night with juniors right now that was just for the shore guys. So we're really trying to identify those guys first, then go out to New Jersey, and then start to hit our secondary areas. And, you know, I want to say that Maryland isn't a secondary area for us anymore. It's become very significant. But at the same time, we really start in the state of New Jersey, making sure we're bringing guys in from, like you said, referenced before, great programs, historically successful programs, and they can come in and bring that same level of commitment and same understanding what it takes to win to our university as well.
Three positions, Coach, that we'd like to break down with you here. And Brian Gabriel, recruiting coordinator, offensive line coach, been with Monmouth for a very long time. Two offensive linemen coming in. That's a spot that always there are players on the recruiting list. I'm actually surprised there's only two. I mean, you're the guy. Don't you get to pull a couple of other strings and bring some more guys in?
I think when the conversation first started, Coach Callahan said we could have one, and then we kind of got to the second one. So we were fortunate enough to bring in two. Last year was a big class for us with offensive linemen. I believe we brought in six. So this year, you know, we had some other areas to address, but we went out and targeted two guys, and we're very excited about them.
Yeah, Justin Zuba, Mark Wolf are those two guys, and, you know, we talked about it when we brought him in. At least initially on paper, you would say 6'7", 260, Zuba, Wolf, 6'4", 270. Big guys, but as those offensive linemen usually do, they will put some weight on, get a little bit stronger, get used to what it is to be a college offensive lineman because it's very different than high school.
Yeah, certainly. I mean, you know, especially talking about Justin, but it just both their body types, they're both guys that have big frames that can build and really just have to grow up. They're 17-year-old kids right now, you know, and they're at that size. So they have all the athletic ability in the world. They have to grow into that body to be able to play at the Division I level. But, you know, the one thing I would speak to both of them is I'm very confident they have the work ethic to do so.
And one thing that you just mentioned is the ability to get stronger, the ability to get bigger, and we're going to take a look at some of the video for Justin Zuba. And we talked inside out. You just mentioned it as well. This guy kind of fits the mold. He's a lineman you look for from nearby Brick Memorial. And what were the things on film that really popped off to you about Justin?
Well, the first thing I'll say about Justin is he runs, you know, a triple option offense. So some of the things he does are significantly different than what we do here. That being said, that's one of the harder positions to evaluate on the offensive line when you do evaluate that. What sold me on Justin was me seeing him live, me seeing him work out, me seeing his natural bend, his natural athleticism. You know, that really showed out. Now, he gets after kids. He's driving them 15, 20 yards down the field, which is very impressive. But I wanted to see other stuff as well in his individual workouts.
What about the tight end spot, Coach? There is one on the list, and, you know, it's maybe a position that has gone the way of extinction just a little bit. But here at Monmouth, tight end, H-back, it's almost a combination spot. It's still important, and I would imagine that you feel pretty good about Herman Pimentel in order to have him be part of the recruiting class and the scholarship process.
Yeah, and, you know, I got to give all the credit in the world to Coach Gallo. He did a phenomenal job evaluating talent at that position. Herman's a guy that has a huge upside as a football player. He's another guy. He's a multi-sport athlete. He's a baseball player. You know, he's a basketball player. As a matter of fact, the other night before his official visit, he had 22 rebounds in a game. So he's got that kind of athletic ability. Now it's just a matter of him fine-tuning his football ability. One of the things that's amazing about him, and I shouldn't say this too loud, but as a defensive player, I think he had 22 sacks as a junior. So he certainly has that edge athletic ability. He was the all-state kind of kid, so we're extremely excited to bring him into the program. And you know, we certainly have been an offense that has used the tight end position one to two on the field all the time, trying to get that vertical and also trying to run the football. So I think he's a guy that can do both and really just got to, you know, again, grow into it. But there's no doubt after meeting him, he's got the work ethic to do so.
And he's got some guys in the program to look up to at the next level. It's pretty cool. And we'll see an interview with Akeem Vallis in a little bit. Neil Sterling, who's made the transition to tight end at the NFL level. I noticed, by the way, Coach Gabe kind of lowered his voice when he talked about Herman's defensive potential. So we'll sure. just get Coach right into the wide receiver spot as well. We discussed local players with Justin Zuba. We have another one. Let's first look at Joey Aldarelli before we take a look at Terrence Green. I know this is a player that down the street, but I know you guys are really high on.
Oh, yeah, no, we're certainly excited about him and would really put him over in the top. We really liked his junior tape. But then he came to our camp and he just competed. He was an excellent route runner. He caught everything that came to him. He just had a knack for getting open. And he's bigger than you think he is. When you first eyeball him, you're like, he's 5'11", you know. And then you get him on the thing. He's 6'1", you know, he's a big, strong kid. He's running away from people. Obviously, having a guy from right down the street, my neighbor where I used to live, right over there. So extremely excited to have him join the program. Exceptional, you know, a route runner, a guy who can certainly catch everything that comes to him. And I think he could be a really good addition to our program.
Coach, let's close the position breakdown for you. Terrence Green from Philadelphia. What's it like to go into the cities, the Philadelphias, the New York cities? You know, this class, I feel like, a little bit different from Monmouth in that they do have pretty good representation. A couple from Brooklyn, a couple from the Bronx, and Green from Philadelphia.
Yeah, certainly. And Coach DeMuzzi did a phenomenal job recruiting Philadelphia for us. Coming from a great program like he came from at St. Joe's. And he's a guy that's kind of the opposite spectrum. We kind of got on him a little later. He didn't have a huge junior year just because of the amount of talent at that school. And then he just blew up his senior year. And, you know, we had the chance to watch his tape. And he's explosive. And I think Eddie alluded to this before. He can score touchdowns. And that's something that, you know, as you watch tape, you just get so excited about. Those guys that you can get the quick screen to that can just do it on their own, make a guy miss, and they're gone. You can't teach that. So extremely excited about that.
And then you not only see on the film his ability as a wide receiver, which we take a look at, but he had great ability in the return game as well. I guess call him a weapon instead of putting him into a position.
Oh, I 100% agree. I mean, I think he could factor into a return game almost immediately because of the ability he does have. And again, he's bigger than you think. He's a longer body at 6'6", 1". Again, I think he can help us in the kick return game, if not immediately, pretty quickly.
Coach, you know, you think about the Monmouth program, which will enter its 25th year next season, and a lot of buzz now with some of the guys in the NFL that Eddie just mentioned, between Neil Sterling and Chris Hogan and Akeem Vallis. And then the other piece of it, and I would think a big piece that the coaches have finally been able to say, not only is it coming, but it's under construction, is the new stadium.
Yeah, and, you know, you alluded to it before. I've been here 15 years, and it's something. I saw this building built, a beautiful basketball arena now called the Ocean First Center that we have, and now to see the stadium construction going on and just seeing how big it is. And I think what a huge step for our university and our program to add that. And quite frankly, in recruiting is something we see every day. It is, and sometimes a facilities war. Some guys, you know, have some good, really good facilities, and taking this step is really going to allow us some legitimacy and some eyes and some big recruits, and I think you started to see it this year.
When you think about the recruiting process, it's Monmouth versus everybody else. You know, you're going against not just schools around the area at both FCS and FBS, but you've got to compete with so many different universities, colleges that all want the same guy.
Sure, and certainly in New Jersey. Now, we said we love to start in New Jersey. One of the hard things about New Jersey is it's so well recruited from so many people because of the level of football and the closeness of all the football programs where you can get to see, you know, 10 scholarship guys in a day just by going to a couple high schools. So certainly, this gives us a legitimacy and allow to keep some really good New Jersey players home.
And then, Coach Gabriel, when you're recruiting to Monmouth University, you've been here, like you said, a long time. Give Matt and I the pitch. What are you selling these? We're not selling, but what are you telling these?
We're already here. We've been here for a long time. He doesn't have to get us here.
It's for them. It's not
if
for
I'm
us.
Not mistaken, both you gentlemen graduated from here, so I don't know if I have to give you that pitch. But the one thing I'd say is I think it starts with the people. You know, I think in this day and age, you know, having a head coach who started the football program, being here 25 years, having a number of our coaches that either played here or have been here a significant amount of time, I think that's the number one selling point. Coach always talks about the message doesn't change. We're consistent. You're going to get that message from us. You can know what to expect. I think that starts with everything. The second thing is the location and now the facilities that we're able to build, how huge of a thing that is for us. And, you know, the third thing is the level of football we're playing and being part of really growing something into it to trying to take that step on the national level that we're trying to make right now.
Coach, appreciate you coming by, giving us some time. I would say get some rest, but you got to worry about next year's class already.
Yeah, no, we're already started. We had a recruiting meeting yesterday on juniors, so we're already getting started with that, and that process just begins. And but today is really a day to celebrate the hard work of our coaches. You know, we've worked extremely hard for a year here, and today we have the culmination of that. We're truly excited about.
Brian Gabriel, recruiting coordinator for Monmouth. 18 players now part of the Hawks program. One that was part, able to catch up with Hakeem Valasuzzi Milano, was able to do that here on campus earlier this week.
I had a chance to sit down with former Monmouth football tight end and current Arizona Cardinal Hakeem Vallis to hear the impact that Monmouth had on him and the success that he's had in the NFL. So you just finished up your rookie season. How would you describe this past year for you in the league?
Started out in the practice squad. You know, it was a very humbling experience, but it was very cool to kind of take the back seat and learn from these veteran guys and going against like the first team defense. Kind of like to compare it to Monmouth, you know, I came here, I redshirted right when I came in. And then I took the back seat to Jacksonville Jaguar, Neil Sterling, at wide receiver. And then I didn't really get to play until my senior year. And, you know, to kind of compare it to my season with the Cardinals, After week four or five, after an injury happened, I got activated and then got put right into the flame. It was pretty cool.
Speaking of Neil Sterling, we also have Chris Hogan in the pros for you guys. What is it like for you to see other Hawks just having that much success?
It's definitely like a sense of pride. Like, you know, it's, you know, he's an opponent on the field, obviously, but, you know, coming from Monmouth University, like, that's, you know, it's awesome. You'd love to just see your, you know, your former teammates or just alumni from your school just have success, whether it's in football or anything.
And you're back on campus now as an alumni. What's it like for you to be here, to see your coaches and see some former teammates?
It's awesome. Like, I went to the basketball game the other day. I got to see all the guys there. I kind of get to motivate these guys, you know, especially guys who, you know, maybe didn't get as much playing time or something like that. I try and just, you know, motivate them and be like, you know, I didn't get my first catch until my senior year. And, you know, some of you guys are going into your senior year, and, you know, where are your dreams, where are your aspirations? Like, you can make the NFL happen too.
What is maybe a little bit of advice that you could give the new guys that are coming to join this Monmouth team?
First of all, congrats to all the new guys coming out. That's awesome. But I think the best worst of advice is just to trust the process. You know, go along with the strength and conditioning program, you know, listen to what the coaches say, you know, do what you got to do in the classroom. So when it comes time to, you know, actually get on the field, there's just no problem. You're ready to go.
What was kind of your recruiting process when you got here?
I still remember getting the first piece of mail from Monmouth, and I still remember that first phone call from Monmouth. Monmouth was my only scholarship going into, coming out of college, which is it's a blessing. And Monmouth, you know, they showed faith and honored my scholarship. My senior year, I tore my labrum, and I didn't play a snap of football in high school my senior year. And every school that was recruiting me, they all dropped me. Never heard a word from them ever again. And Monmouth just honored it, committed, and now we're here. And I remember coming on campus, and this place was small, but it felt like home.
What is one of your favorite moments from being here at Monmouth?
I definitely say one of my favorite moments is probably when we beat Liberty my senior year. I think the game went to overtime as well, and it was just, that win was one of the greatest feelings. Just, it was just a great sense of pride, just a great sense of, we've worked so hard for this, like we needed this win, and it felt amazing.
And there's a few changes going on campus here right now. What are you most excited to see?
Oh, I'm super excited to see the new stadium. That's just awesome. You know, obviously, there's a sense of jealousy you feel for, like, that's all, like, these guys get to have a stadium. You know, we didn't really get to have a big stadium, but I think it's definitely, like, a sense of pride. You know, you're coming back, and all the years of, you know, work you put in, all the years of work that everyone's put in since, you know, Coach Cal's first class in 92, and what it's created, you know, what's manifested, you know, after all those years, and now you got big stadium coming. It's pretty cool.
Is there something that you learned here at Monmouth that you've taken with you moving forward into the league?
I think definitely my sense of just of hard work, and, you know, having that chip on your shoulder, you know, being a small school guy. But it's definitely hard work and just always being the hardest working, you know, person on the field at all times. And I think Coach Jeff Gallo, he's, you know, he instilled that in me just from day one when I moved to tight end. And there's just never take a day off, ever, you know, no matter what.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much and good luck moving forward.
I appreciate it. Thanks for having me.
Great spot, Susie Milano, who will join us in just a little bit, talking with some of the mid-year players that Monmouth has brought in, spending some time with Akeem Vallis. And, Coach, let's start right there as we welcome in head coach Kevin Callahan, Matt Harmon, Eddie Iacopinti on our ESPN3 National Signing Day. The number of players now that Monmouth has been able to turn over into the NFL, go back to Miles Austin, but right now, great representation. You've got Hakeem in there. You've got Chris Hogan. You've got Neil Sterling. It's been now kind of almost a year-by-year thing where Monmouth has guys getting into the next league.
Well, I think that's a testament to the hard work that our coaches put in. They're tireless recruiters. They go out and they bring in not only great football players but great people into the university and into the football program here. And once they're here, they become part of a program that has a very strong work ethic, that's very disciplined and very structured. And you take these great resources that come into the program and you work with them over a 4 or 5 year period. And the result is that you're going to have guys going to the next level and playing on Sundays. And that's something that we're very proud of.
And it's so nice to see that you'll have one guy playing this Sunday, Chris Hogan, whose story has been told by pretty much every major, minor, and medium-sized news outlet. The 4 years at Penn State, the 1 year here for Monmouth, now with the New England Patriots. I know you've been extremely busy as his football coach talking about what Hogan did in his 1 year here at Monmouth.
Well, you know, Chris was only with us for a very short period of time. It was just a little over 3 months. But the impact that he had on our program here was tremendous. He was a guy that almost immediately you were able to see the level of athlete that he was and how very talented he was. As a matter of fact, he was able to play both sides of the football for us, although he started out as a receiver and had immediate success there, scoring a touchdown on his very first reception of his career. It then became necessary to play him in the defensive secondary, and from about the fourth game on, he played about 70 plays on defense and probably 15 to 20 plays on offense, and he impacted the game in everything that he did. As a matter of fact, the very first game that he played in the defensive secondary, on about a day and a half of practice, he had 2 interceptions in the first half, returned one of them for 30 yards that set up a touchdown. He was a dominant special teams player, yet he continued to catch balls and to score touchdowns in every game. So just a tremendous athlete. We couldn't be happier for the success he's having and also how he's doing it on such a national stage.
Hey, Coach, it's pretty cool that the path of all of your NFL Hawks, it's sort of been very different, obviously. Like you said, started with Miles Austin, and he was the one that broke through. But from him through Chris Hogan, I guess if you could say it to the players in the program now and to the recruits, there's not one roadmap that gets you to the next level, but there's a few common themes that are probably there.
Well, there are, and as you mentioned, Eddie, Miles was the guy who opened the door. And I think he's the one that made it possible or made people take notice that NFL-caliber players do, in fact, come out of the Monmouth program. And since Miles, we've had a guy just about every single year who's had an opportunity to play in the National Football League. Some have stayed longer than others. Some have had more extended careers. But I think what is nationally recognizable now is that Monmouth University from the Big South and formerly from the NEC is putting out professional-grade players each and every year. As I said, that's something that we're very proud of. It's something that the players in our program take a great deal of pride of.
Head coach Kevin Callahan with us here on our ESPN Signing Day special. Monmouth introducing 18 new players into the program. We'll talk with Coach about that a little bit. But before we jump into that, it's going to be a special year for Monmouth this coming season in the fall of 2017, the 25th year of football. And as you saw with that video with Hakeem, the demo that took place, I know that you probably wish you had the sledgehammer out for the old stadium, but the new one is going to be extremely exciting.
Well, you know, we've been fortunate to be out there just about every day, and we've seen every stage of the new construction, from the demolition of the old Kessler Field, the old Monmouth Stadium, to the construction of the new one. And every day it seems to literally grow up out of the ground. It's been something that we talked about for a number of years, but to see it actually happening, to see it actually coming to fruition, is certainly something that we're excited about. And it's something that was desperately needed. You know, we're in an era of college athletics now where facilities are important. It's an arms race, and on a national level, recruits are looking for not just what type of program you have or what type of school you have. They're looking at your facilities and where you're going to play and the venue that their families are going to watch games in, and that's an important part of it. And I'm very happy to say what we are putting together right now, the construction that's going on right now, is going to be a first-class FCS facility, something that every one of our athletes will be extremely proud of, something that this university will be extremely proud of.
And, you know, Coach, for me, as someone who's been around all the way back to 1993, you look at what has taken place with this 18-player class. How different was it maybe this year, knowing that the stadium itself was actually going to happen and it wasn't a recruiting pitch, and I don't mean that in a bad way, but over you know, this stadium has been talked about for a long time, but this was a year that you could actually say the new stadium will be there in 2017.
Well, you know, after 25 years, Matt, I'll be honest, I can pitch just about anything, and I can sell just about anything, but it's an awful lot easier when it's actually coming out of the ground and you can point to it, and you don't have to have people close their eyes and imagine this. I mean, now the stadium is a reality. Every single day, there's progress that's being made out there. Every single day, every player in our program gets excited about the opportunity of opening the 2017 season here at our new stadium.
All right, let's look at the class a little bit with the head coach, Kevin Callahan. 18 players coming in. Just an overall feel for where you feel like this class is, as opposed to maybe even the last couple since joining the Big South. This one might be one that can come in and make more of an immediate type impact.
Well, I think it absolutely will, and we've got to give credit to our entire coaching staff under the direction of our recruiting coordinator, Brian Gabriel, who I think did an outstanding job of going out and finding some very talented athletes to come in and not only meet some of our needs, but also to upgrade positions where we felt we needed to upgrade. It's a very talented class, top to bottom. It meets the needs that we did establish as a coaching staff in terms of where we needed to upgrade some talent. And I think it's a class that you're going to see and hear from very early on in their careers.
And you can look right away and just go by the numbers. Obviously, a position of need this season was the defensive back. Four players of the 18 all in that back four.
Well, it's an area that's extremely important, particularly in the Big South. The Big South is a very athletic conference. Teams have the ability to throw the ball. They spread the field on you, and you need as many players on the back end with the ability to make plays as you can possibly get. And I think the four young men that we brought in this year's class are guys that will impact us very early on in their careers.
And Coach, one of the themes we saw with those four defensive backs, and I think Matt and I talked about it earlier, want to get your thoughts on it, is the size that they have. It's important we see for those bigger defensive backs, especially at the corner spot, to be able to challenge physical wide receivers on the outside, but also step up and run support with DBs having to play more on early downs.
Well, you know, no offense to the 5'7 guys like the three of us up here right now, but the era of the 5'6 corner who's tough as nails and will run through a wall for you is gone. You better have a 6-footer back there who's close to 190, 200 pounds, who has the ability to take on tall, physical receivers. As you guys know, the receivers now are anywhere from 6'2 to 6'4, and you've got to have guys that can match up with them every single down. And one of the things that we're emphasizing in recruiting defensive secondary is to get taller, longer, bigger bodies, guys that have a physical presence about them, but yet also who retain the athleticism and the ability to change direction and move and run and do all the things that a defensive back needs to do.
And you have coached defensive backs. That's where you got your start going all the way back. And you just said it. You kind of just laid out the evolution of the position for us. So we don't have a chance anymore, huh?
No, I think you guys are out.
We will not be part of the class of 2018, let's say that. You know,
it's for the best.
Coach, interesting in that four-player defensive back, Hassan Muhammad Chambers and Justin Terry both from the same high school, Christ the King, from up in Brooklyn.
Two players from the same high school, a very, very good high school, a very successful high school program, and both bring a little bit different skill set to the table. Justin is a guy that we project at corner. He's a very physical player that shows good range. He has very good ball skills, has the ability to match up and cover people one-on-one, has the ability to play the field corner and take receivers out of the game. Hassan is more of a physical player that we're going to project at one of the inside positions as a safety. Outstanding tackler, has great range, has great vision and good ball skills. He has the ability to adjust the ball in the air and go get it and make plays on it.
Coach, one of the things that we not only see in the needs of that defensive back spot, but also we mentioned some of the guys leaving the program, and leaving the program as an incredibly productive player on the defensive line, and Darnell Leslie, and hopefully he's one of those next Hawks in the pros that we talk about. And with that, you bring in three defensive linemen, and we know the premium that getting to the quarterback is for that position. Just address kind of overall that group.
Well, I think when you look at that group, you've got two guys that we're projecting as interior players, and that's Kurt Almer and Jerron Prendarvis, who's with us right now. They have the ability to push the pocket from the inside, to collapse it into the quarterback's face. They have the ability to get their hands on defenders, to lock people out, and be a very effective run stoppers. In the other position, Terrence Maynard is a very tall, long, athletic player that has a tremendous ability to bend. He's got great explosiveness off the line. He has the ability to turn the corner and beat tackles to the outside with a speed rush move. He's a guy that we've seen has is capable of really chasing down plays from the backside because he has great quickness and closing ability.
Coach, you know, one of the positions that, you know, generally each recruiting class would have probably one quarterback, so you can kind of keep up with the consistency of that position. But this year a little bit unique in that Monmouth will bring in two. One mid-year transfer, Max Smythe from down at Palmyra, and also Brandon Harris, the quarterback from the Bronx. Maybe the idea and the thought process in terms of bringing in two rather than just one, which would be the norm.
Well, it was a position where we needed to add more arms. We needed to add more personnel to the position. We really only returned two scholarship players at the position at the end of the 2016 season. So it was important for us that we felt to bring in two players at that spot. And ideally, it worked out so that one of the guys, Max Smythe, was able to join us at mid-year. He's a New Jersey product. He played his prep school football down in North Carolina. He's a big, tall, pocket-type passer. He's got a very strong arm, the ability to put the ball on receivers and make plays. He also has enough athleticism to extend plays and get himself out of trouble. And we're very excited to have him with us here now and get started working with him as we head into spring practice. Brandon Harris will be a freshman entering in the fall, extremely athletic, has the ability to make plays with his feet as well as with his arm. He's a guy you can't fall asleep on defense because he can pull the ball down and run and make huge plays running the ball, but he can really whip the ball with his arm. He's very accurate as a passer. He can put it on receivers, and he has big capability in both areas.
You know, Coach, Eddie and I mentioned before that if you're a player going to whatever school it is, and in this case, Monmouth, you look at maybe what's ahead of you. So with that quarterback spot, is the idea saying, hey, you know, we have a guy who played last year in Kenji Bahar, but other than that, the position is fairly wide open.
Well, it is, and ideally you want people in every position that love to compete, that want to go out and see how good they can be, and they're going to put themselves to the test each and every day. And I think when you look at the players that we have in the position, both the guys that are returning and the two new guys that are joining us, you see players with that makeup, players that have that mentality that they're going to go out, compete to be their best every single opportunity they have.
And, Coach, one of the positions that you take a look at, and just two individuals, but two apparently really impact guys at the running back spot that are going to have – to come in, and there's a lot of production graduating from this program, and LaVon Chaney, one of the best really dual threat or multi-talented running backs the Big South's ever seen and Monmouth's ever seen. So we look at these two guys in Justin Brown and Eric Zakori, and you must have liked them as an immediate impact kind of thing because you're losing three guys.
Well, we're losing three guys, and as you mentioned, Ed, three guys who are extremely productive. There's literally nothing that LaVon didn't do for us. He impacted our offense and our team in so many ways. He wasn't very big, but he was extremely durable and had the ability to make plays, doing just about everything. He was also terrific in pass protection. But what we've got coming in, Justin Brown is a bigger, more physical type running back, 210 pounds. He's extremely durable. He's the guy that you could give the ball to 25 times a game, and he's only going to get stronger as it goes. He put up great numbers in high school, and he's a guy that can really be your workhorse, but yet he has extremely big play capability. Eric is a guy who can do a lot of different things. He's just as effective as a receiver coming out of the backfield as he was carrying the ball. He's a guy that's got the ability to stick his foot in the ground and get vertical, to jump cut, to make people miss. He runs with terrific vision. So the combination of both Justin and Eric is something that we're very excited about.
And I was shocked at one thing on Eric's tape, and it's not any of his skills. I saw a quarterback under center, Coach. You don't see that too often anymore.
Well, you don't see that too often anymore. But, anyways, we're going to get him the rock as much as we can.
Coach, you know, both of those guys, Zachary, a Maryland guy, and Justin Brown from Connecticut, you know, interesting that you went outside of New Jersey to try and find other guys that you can bring in and, again, maybe think about contributing right away.
Well, you know, as you know, Matt, we always try to start the recruiting process from the inside out. But at the end of the day, it's about going out and getting the best players that are the best fit for Monmouth University and the Monmouth football program. When we find guys who we feel are a good fit and they also have the skills and the talents that we feel are necessary to win in this level and to win in this conference, we're going to do everything we can to get them here at Monmouth. And in both Justin and Eric, we found two guys like that.
Two guys to conclude here with, Coach, before we move on to a couple other things, Daquan Cooper and also Eric Massey, two linebackers. And, Coach, that linebacker spot maybe was a bit of an issue last year. There were several times that Monmouth played six defensive backs, maybe more out of need because the linebacker depth maybe wasn't there. There were some injuries that took place during the course of the year. So just like the running back spot, maybe these guys have a chance to come in and be those guys who can get themselves on the field.
Well, what we're seeing in college football is the evolution of the linebacker position. No longer is the guy who stands inside in the box in A-gap and just plays football for, you know, three downs a series. It's got to be a guy who's versatile. It's got to be a guy who has some athleticism, somebody who can move out into coverage, somebody who can cover an athletic running back in a pass pattern. So we're asking this position to do a lot more than we ever have. And in both Dewan and Eric, we've got guys who are athletic, who bring really a multifaceted skill set to what they do. They both have the ability to come off the edge and be effective pass rushers and blitzers. They both have the ability to run with receivers and tight ends and match up in the pass game. And they both have the physical presence and explosiveness to play downhill into the run game. So they bring the skill set that we think is required to play football these days, and we're really looking forward to what these guys can do.
Especially, Coach, with how these teams play in the Big South and the athleticism that not only is on the outside at the running back position, really big offensive linemen, how important is it to find those running backs, to find those linebackers, rather, like you said, that can literally and have to do everything on the field?
Well, the broader the skill set, certainly the more valuable they are. And you've got to combine that with size and length. So I think in both these guys, we have guys who are long bodies. They have tremendously long arms. They have the ability to play with their hands, but it's their athleticism and their explosiveness that really excites us.
18 players for Monmouth introduced today, 7 from New Jersey, 3 from New York, 3 Maryland, 3 Pennsylvania, and 2 for Connecticut. Hawks will start spring practice on Monday, March 27th, which will lead us into the 2017 season, which will be the 25th year for Monmouth in terms of being on the gridiron and being here in West Long Branch. And, Coach, it'll be a special year, silver anniversary of the program, brand new stadium. Let's talk about the schedule a bit for next season. It will be a mix of a couple of home games to start things off, which will be nice to christen in the new stadium. A lot of road games and yet another year in the Big South.
Well, you know, after being home only 3 times in 2016, having a full slate of a home schedule is something that excites us. It's also exciting that we'll have an opportunity to christen and open the new stadium. Our first 2 games will be at home, our home opener on September 2nd against Lafayette, and then a week later, another Patriot League opponent in Lehigh will come to West Long Branch. We have 2 other Patriot League teams on the schedule in Holy Cross and Bucknell. We will play University at Albany, which is from the CAA, and we'll also play Hampton from the MEAC. So I think it's a very competitive non-conference schedule. It's a very regional non-conference schedule that has a Northeast flavor to it. And then, as you know, we get into the highly competitive Big South, and each and every week in the Big South is a grind. And every coach on our staff, every player in our program understands that you really have to be at your best every single week in the Big South if you hope to be successful.
Coach, let's wrap up. You know, longtime head coach, the only one that the school has had. This will be your 25th year. How much has the recruiting process changed from when you started? I mean, listen, you took guys off the street, because I can attest to that, to what it is now. It's an evolving process that never really ever finishes.
Well, it's changed dramatically. And you know, nowadays with social media and everything is known instantaneously. But it used to be where you would play your football season, and then there would be a period of a couple of months where you really focused on recruiting. Then you would get that class, you would turn the page, and then you would start preparing for the next season. The way it works nowadays, and it has for a couple years, is you recruit 365 days a year straight. You never take a break, and you hope that you can find 11 or 12 Saturdays maybe where you can play some football games. And that's really how it's evolved. You have to recruit 365 days a year. As Coach Gabriel mentioned earlier, we started yesterday working on next year's class before this class had even put pen to the paper. But that's what you got to do. You have to do to stay on top of things. And I think our coaching staff does a great job of being on top of their specifically recruiting areas and understanding what it takes to be successful on a recruiting front today.
Coach, I know a busy day. Appreciate you coming by and giving us a lot of time. Continued success with this class, and we'll see you in March for spring practice and next September.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it.
That's the head coach, Kevin Callahan. We will take a quick timeout. When we come back, we'll talk with two of the mid-year players that Monmouth has brought in. Eddie and I will wrap things up from there. We thank you so much for spending part of your National Signing Day with us here on ESPN.
Can you hear me?
The buzz around college football continues all around the country. We've introduced the 18 players, two of which are here on campus already in West Long Branch. Susie Milano standing by with both Jerron Pendarvis and also Max Smythe.
Thanks, guys. First of all, congratulations and welcome officially to this Monmouth squad. When you first started getting recruited, what would you say stuck out about Monmouth?
Definitely a family atmosphere here at Monmouth. Like around the guys, just really get along. I really get along with the guys pretty well. Like a real family atmosphere pretty much is why I decided Monmouth.
And what are some of those goals that you maybe have set for yourself for this upcoming season?
Definitely to make an impact very early, starting with spring ball. It's good that I enrolled early so I can get along with all the guys, get comfortable before the fall comes up.
Thank you so much. Good luck.
Thank you.
All right, moving on to you. Like he said, you guys have already been here working out a little bit. What is something that you've been doing to help prep you for this upcoming season?
We've been mainly focused on getting bigger and stronger as a team, working on conditioning every Wednesday, getting better shape.
And what are you most excited for?
I'm excited for the season, setting big goals for myself, and hopefully having a great semester.
Awesome. Good luck.
Thank you.
Back to you guys.
She appreciate it. Max Smythe, the quarterback, and Jerron Pendarvis, defensive line, part of the 18-player class that Monmouth has. So important, I think, Eddie, to get those guys in when you can, mid-year guys. They have that whole extra spring that they can deal with, get acclimated to school, get acclimated to the campus, get acclimated to the football program. It's really a big bonus.
Matt, it helps with the adjustment process. Like you said, whether that adjustment comes from high school or from a school in between, a junior college or a prep school, and just the more you're around a program and the more that you're around also how they go about their business, whether it's in the locker room, whether it's meeting time and the classes and everything else, that adjustment is huge in as far as getting players comfortable and then on the field earlier in their time.
You think about the schedule that we flashed the graphic up. Maybe we can bring it up one more time. Talk about what's coming in 2017. Couple of games at home against Patriot League teams, Lehigh, Lafayette, both on there. Lafayette, the first one, will christen the new stadium. And then four in a row on the road. Albany, Hampton, Bucknell, Holy Cross, all those non-league games before the grind, Eddie, of the Big South season gets up and going with October 21st home against Liberty.
Yeah, that bye week, October 14th, perfectly placed as that kind of divider in the book between your non-league and your league schedule. And Matt, we mentioned how good this conference really is. You know, last year we saw, again, just the depth of this conference as well. That game October 21st against Liberty, last time the Flames went to West Long Branch, Monmouth won that game, first time beating a ranked opponent. But you mentioned how just strong this schedule is, top to bottom. You like those first two games at home if you're Coach Callahan at Monmouth Stadium against, how about those old rivals, Lafayette and Lehigh? Hopefully they don't pass on the way back to Northeast Pennsylvania. A good schedule. Coach always challenges this program.
You know, what's missing on that schedule, if you are a fan of Monmouth football, you might look at it and say, where's the FBS game? It's been something that Monmouth has played the last couple of years. Nothing on for 2017, but there are three games that have been scheduled from 2018, 2019, and 2020.
And something about those games that I've really taken an interest in, those are three bowl teams at the FBS level that are incredibly good, and you'll see it's visiting Eastern Michigan, Western Michigan, and then in Central Michigan in the next couple of years. Matt, those are good teams from a really strong conference that we have seen up close and personal the last couple of seasons, going out to Central Michigan already, playing a Kent State team that has players that are being projected at the next level as well. And it's, again, we talked about the evolution and mentioned just where this program is from a trajectory standpoint, and playing those games and having them scheduled out this far in advance, it's huge. It's something you can look at a recruit and say you're going to get a chance to prove yourself against this caliber of team, and it's something that Coach is going to continue to do with this group.
Let's talk about how important this particular class will be as we get set to kind of wrap things up. Monmouth with good representation in terms of the all-league selections from a year ago, so you lose talent, you've got to make sure that you get talent back in.
Yeah, that's the kind of the duality of National Signing Day, right? There's players leaving the program, and you're going to have to get great ones in the program, and you'll see Monmouth's all Big South representation, and it starts with one of the best defensive players, one of the best players in all of FCS football in Mike Basile. After that, how about the anchor on the offensive line in Alex Thompson? Reggie White Jr. is the best receiver in the Big South Conference. And then the guys leaving, Darren Ambush, Darnell Leslie, as far as the all-league guys, Matt, those are two players that are really leaving a lot of production. And not only that, they're great kids that are moving on from Monmouth.
Yeah, well, it'll be interesting to see how quick. And I think that's always the thought, right? So last year when we did this, we talked about 2016 recruiting class. A lot of those guys didn't really get on the field because you take that redshirt year, especially at this level of football. But for 2017 and for a Monmouth team that's trying to rebound off of a 4-7 season a year ago, it could be a chance that where this young batch of Monmouth players, last year's class, this year's class, gets themselves on the field much earlier.
Well, and we heard Coach say that as well. As the programs continue to evolve and playing this level of football, you're going after now a different caliber of student-athlete in the recruiting world. And when you bring those players in, you want to get them ready. You want to get them on the field as soon as they're prepared.
Well, we thank you so much for spending part of your signing day with us here in West Long Branch, New Jersey. Congratulations to the 18 student-athletes who are now member of the Monmouth football program. Our thanks to Brian Gabriel. Our thanks to Coach Callahan. Our thanks to Hakeem Vallis. For Susie Milano, Eddie Acapinti, I'm Matt Harmon. We'll see you in September for college football. Enjoy the rest of the coverage all during the course of the day on ESPN and ESPN3.